subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
The Naga peace talks, intended to put an end to a conflict that spanned over 70 years in Northeast, have resumed in Delhi last week. For this round of the talks, the National Socialist Council of Nagaland, Isaac Muiva, have said that they will stick to the demand for a separate flag and constitution. To understand the argument behind these demands, let's take a look at the history of Naga political movement. The Naga peace talks refer to the talks undertaken between the government of India and various stakeholders in Nagaland to resolve decades-old issues which find its roots in the colonial era when the Naga hills became a part of British India. A peace accord between the government and Naga National Council was signed on 11th November 1975 when Indira Gandhi was the Prime Minister and was called the Shillong Accord. The Naga National Council, led by Angami Zafar Fizo, who declared independence of Naga region on 14th August 1947, a day before India's Independence Day, promised to give up arms, but several senior leaders within the group did not agree and broke away to float their own factions. One such faction, the National Socialist Council of Nagaland, NSCN, was formed on 31st January 1980 by Isaac Chishi Su, Twengeling Muiva and SS Kaplang. They opposed the Shillong Accord, but differences surfaced within this outfit as well over the issue of starting a dialogue with the center, and on 30th April 1988, the NSCN split into two factions, namely NSCN K led by SS Kaplang and NSCN IM led by Isaac Chishi Su and Twengeling Muiva. The Isaac Muiva faction of the NSCN is one of the biggest and oldest Naga rebel outfits and has been in peace talks with the center after it signed the ceasefire agreement in 1997 when H.D. Dave Gowda was the Prime Minister. The armed rebel groups have been fighting for a greater Nagaland or Nagalim, seeking to bring together as many as 1.2 million Nagas within one territory, from Naga-dominated areas in neighboring Assam, Manipur and Arunachal Pradesh. Isaac Chishi Su died in 2016 in a hospital in Delhi. He had been ailing for the past year before his death. And SS Kaplang passed away in Myanmar's Taga in 2018, a Naga self-administered zone, which means that the 86-year-old Twengeling Muiva now leads the NSCN. A new push to the peace talks was given when Prime Minister Narendra Modi came to power in 2014. 1 year later, on 3rd August 2015, a framework agreement was signed between the center's representative R.N. Ravi and the NSCN. The agreement was aimed as a final peace settlement to the longest-running insurgency. The framework, which recognized the unique history and culture of the Naga people, was signed on the principle of coexistence and shared sovereignty, which meant that the Nagas will coexist with the Indian government, sharing sovereign powers as an honorable solution, but will not merge with India. Until last week, when a high-ranking executive member of the NSCN-IM steering committee, Mr. V. Horam, told the print that the peace talks interlocutor and Nagaland's governor R.N. Ravi was insulting the armed groups by calling them gangsters and was converting a political issue into a law and order problem in the state. This will force the Nagas to return to the fighting days, even though they are now committed to living in peace with the Indian Union, Horam said. Significantly, Horam insisted that NSCN would have the right to collect taxes from the people.
You levy tax, we do that. We're not telling you not to levy tax. You have your right to do that and leave that to us. As far as extortion is concerned, that we are also against. That we also check. But otherwise, as for the normal legal taxation, you have no right to say anything on that. And it will continue. Whether Ravi says or not, whether anybody says or not, whether the government of India says or not, that's what our stand is. It's very clear, very clear.
Horam's remarks coincide with Muiva's visit to Delhi, where he met intelligence bureau chief and senior officials in the hope of resolving the deadlock. But sources have told the print that the center will never concede either on sovereignty or in the matter of collecting taxes by any other group except the state.
R.N. Ravi's Independence Day speech was predictably hard-hitting. He attacked vested interests preventing the peace dividend from reaching the state. This was seen by the Naga rebels as an attack on them.
Regrettably, the waves of positive changes and growth seem to have been bypassing our state, Nagaland. Nagaland is the 16th state of the Indian Union, the second oldest state in the region. It is endowed with one of the finest human and natural resources. For quite some decades, since its birth, it raced ahead of several other states in the region despite odds. Unfortunately, today, it has the dubious distinction of the worst performing state in the country, including the Northeast region, on almost all the significant indicators of human development.
Question is, will the Nagas at last find an honorable solution to the decades-old insurgency and make peace, or will they be forced to go back to the fighting days? With the Modi government revoking Article 370 in Jammu and Kashmir last year, the Naga integration with the Indian Union is perhaps the major outstanding problem from history. The rest of India is now watching whether and how a compromise can be struck. This is Yamkamala Longkumar with Angana Chakrabarti for The Print.